Welcome to December's Coastal Gardener. You know, December is the month for a lot of holiday topics. Later on, Chantel Welker will be in the kitchen. We'll have Mark Weekly, our Arboretum coordinator, talking about some interesting containers and the ways to put those together. But of course, when we talk about December and plants, we think about Christmas trees. And Christmas trees is something that's a traditional part of our holiday decorating. A few things to keep in mind when you get ready to go out and purchase a Christmas tree. If you're going to buy a cut tree off the lot, remember, make sure you have room for the plant. It may sound a little silly, especially if you've moved to a new location. Measure the area, because these trees look a lot larger once you get them home than they do out here on the lot. The other question a lot of people ask is, which one should I get? The most popular cut tree in North Carolina and a lot of this part of the world is the Fraser fir. These are grown in the mountains of North Carolina. They won't grow around here, so don't waste your time buying one to plant later. They won't work. But as a cut Christmas tree, this is a great plant. Holds its needles well. It really is far superior to a lot of the ones we typically use. White pines, red cedars, some of the other things like Leyland cypress you may find grown in the eastern part of the state, but they're not going to last inside like Fraser fir does. Otherwise, when you go to buy one other than the ultimate size, like most things, Christmas trees are graded. If you look at really high quality trees, they're going to be thicker, they're not going to have holes, they're going to be just a better looking tree, but like most of those things, you're going to pay more for those. So you're going to be looking at quality and at size. The other thing is it fresh? A relatively easy way to tell is just to grasp one of the branches and just pull gently across that and see if a lot of needles come off in your hands. If they don't, you're in good shape. Another way to do it is to lift the plant off the ground and bring it down on the stump. If you see a lot of needles falling off the exterior of the plant, you may want to look at a different tree. Once you've chosen that perfect tree, you may want to get the lot owners or the guys that are selling it to you, or you can do it yourself, to cut a couple of inches off the stump. Once that tree's been cut in the mountains, it kind of seals up and it won't take up water once you put it in the stand. So refresh that cut an inch or so and make sure you've got the lower limbs where it'll fit into the stand. And once you do that, make sure you don't allow that stand or whatever reservoir it is to dry out. You want to keep water around it all the time. Other people will tell you you need to add aspirin, you need to put Sprite in there, you need to do all kinds of different things. The tree preservatives may have some value, but the main thing is make sure you have water. The Christmas tree may be the centerpiece of a lot of your holiday decorating, but they're not the only holiday plant. One of the really easy holiday plants to grow are what we now call holiday cactus. In the old days, we called them Christmas cactus, Thanksgiving cactus, even Easter cactus, depending on the time of the blooming. But now they're kind of all hybridized together and we just call them holiday cactus. There is some difference in the way they bloom and the timing. You can see this red one that I have here next to me is a little bit earlier than the kind of apricot colored one, and even a little bit later is the pink one that we have here. But they're all in that group we call zygocactus. Now keep in mind, these are not true cacti. They don't need to be in really dry, full sun, hot kind of conditions. These plants come from the South and Central American jungle. So they don't really need to be treated like something that would be out in the desert. If you do that, you're not going to have good success. As I said, it's a really easy plant to keep from year to year. All you really have to do is, this time of year, obviously enjoy the blooms. If you don't already have one, purchase one. Once the blooms fade, just put them in a place in bright light inside. Keep them evenly moist. Don't let them dry out. That's an old recommendation. Then once the spring comes and the danger of frost is past, move them out to a relatively shaded location. I always put them on my back porch. You don't want them in full sun. If they need repotting, that'd be a good time to do that. Put them in a little larger container so they'll grow a little larger then. Fertilize them with your typical slow release fertilizer and just leave them alone and keep them evenly moist. Leave them out through the summer, and then when the danger of frost comes back in the fall, bring them inside. They'll set flower buds and you'll have a whole new crop of flowers. So like, it's a very easy group of plants to deal with. And they're also pretty easy to propagate too. All you have to do is take these sections of pads, just pop one off like that, stick that right into some well-drained potting media, and it'll root fairly quickly. So if you want to share your plant, relatively easy thing to do. Now, of course, the plant that most people think about for the holidays and for Christmas is poinsettia, and it still is the most popular potted plant. Just a couple of things to keep in mind with those. You're always going to pay more for ones that have more colorful bracts. So that's going to be the difference in the pricing. The other thing is, remember to look at the true flowers where the little yellow pollen, the cyathia, in the middle of all those colorful bracts. You want those to be tightly closed and not showing a lot of pollen. You know that plant's got a long life ahead of it, probably even into February for a lot of them now if you take reasonably good care of them. Treat the poinsettia like you would a bouquet of flowers. Take the foil off, or either at least punch a hole so the water will drain out. Put them in bright light, but keep them away from cold and hot drafts. And they, like I said, they'll last a long, long time, the newer varieties. Red is still the most popular one, but there are many marbled and pinks and whites and all kinds of different poinsettias now. So check with your local supplier and go early, because a lot of times they sell out of the really cool new ones. So we have the zygote cactus or holiday cactus and the poinsettia. Stick with us, we have Mark Weekly to show you some interesting ways to do containers for the garden.
What we do to the planet, we do to ourselves. You can help keep America beautiful. Visit kab.org.
Welcome back to the show. You know, we've got a great treat for you today to talk about containers for the garden, something we haven't talked about a whole lot. We have Mark Weekly, who's our Arboretum Coordinator here at the New Hanover County Arboretum. Mark, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Got a big blue container, cobalt blue container here with all these plants around it. But before we get into the specifics of that, why do we add containers to the garden to begin with, Mark?
Well, there's a couple of reasons. A lot of times, if you have a very small space and you want to add more color, you can rise above the ground. Or if you're on a patio or something with no place to plant but want color, mm-hmm. Container is the perfect answer. And a lot of times, like in the case of some of these plants, I've got something that I want to grow on a few years before I put it in my garden. Mm-hmm. So I'll throw it in a pot for a while, take care of it, give a little TLC, and then in a couple of years it's a little more established, then I can move it out.
So all kinds of different opportunities. I guess a lot of times most people, when they think about containers, they think about flowering annuals. Mm-hmm. And that's a relatively short list for the wintertime around here, but you're thinking not just flowering annuals, huh?
No, I like to throw some unusual conifers in, mm-hmm. Find a neat little evergreen or a grass you can't live without. I like to throw that in, and there's nothing wrong with throwing a pansy or two in for some instant color, but mm-hmm. the form and the texture, that's all you need.
What about the types of containers? What do you suggest for something that would go outside?
Well, you want something fairly heavy and thick. The glazed pots are about the best way to go, but even in a bad winter, you can lose those. Mm-hmm. Clay pots last a few seasons if you're fortunate. It just depends on what you're willing to spend. I mean, you can go find an old whiskey barrel somewhere that works just perfect and let it sit there until it rots away.
Just depends on what your garden situation is, I guess. You've got
exactly.
This pretty blue one here. Was there any rhyme or reason to choosing that color, or is that just one you like?
It was one I liked. It was a simple shape. I can move it around, and cobalt blue just is gorgeous in a garden.
Yeah, it goes with a lot of different stuff. Tell us a little bit about what you should use in the container. I know there are a lot of people who, you know, they say, well, I don't want to buy all that potting soil. I want to mix some garden soil in. What do you suggest on that?
I usually try not to mix the garden soil in. Mm-hmm. You don't want anything that's going to compact a lot. That's why the potting mix usually has perlite or something in to make mm-hmm. it light and fluffy. I mean, it's very easy for it to all just become a pot of mud, and that's the last thing you want. You want it to breathe and drain.
Yeah, I guess drainage is one of the, when we think about drainage in a container, garden soil just usually doesn't work very well.
Yep.
Another thing that we always talk about, a lot of people think that you're supposed to put gravel in the bottom of it to get drainage, and obviously that's a negative to your drainage rather than a positive. Yeah. So you're better not to add the rock or brick chips in the bottom, unless you're just trying to keep, if you got big holes or something, where the media may come out. But
true.
Otherwise, potting media all the way down, I guess, would be the right way to do it, wouldn't it?
Yep.
Okay, well, we know what kind of container we like. We know what we're going to grow it in, which would be the potting soil that we're going to buy. Let's talk a little bit about some of the plants you have here and some potential combinations.
Okay. Well, like I say, I like to find, and I'm not alone, I like to find neat little unusual plants. This one's actually on loan to us by a friend of ours. Came all the way from Oregon.
Wow.
And I have no idea what it is. Little Dr. Seuss tree. It's beautiful. Excellent container, the way it was put together. You've got the contrast of colors, contrast of shapes. And even though these two sedums will flower, you don't need a flower in that pot at all. It's beautiful as is.
Lots of foliage color and interesting form there, contrasting form. So, Mark, we got a nice little container here, but we got a whole bunch of other stuff that you might want to use in the larger container. Tell us a little bit about some of those.
Well, little combination of things. This is a new arborvitae on the market. It's called Mr. Bowling Ball. It's a real soft texture for a needle evergreen. Nice shape to it. Would look very good as a centerpiece, and maybe you could throw something like the Acorus around it. It would give it this little bit of a skirt splashing out. That would be one nice combination. This is something more typical of what you're used to seeing around the wintertime, flowering kale. Again, a beautiful plant. And it's nothing wrong with combining an annual with the conifers. My particular favorite, and the one that I know I will put in this pot, is a new variety of the shore juniper. This is the golden shore. Most people are common with the blue, but I can't help putting chartreuse against cobalt blue. It's just a striking combination.
Yeah, it looks good.
And I'm also going to backfill it with another unusual plant for a container. I'm going to put an azalea in. It's a little small, give it a few years to grow, but you can't beat the burgundy and this. You've already got three colors and two plants. So.
And this one, tell us a little bit about that particular azalea, because that's a relatively new series of azalea, isn't it?
It is. This was developed in Louisiana. It's called the Crimson Azalea series. This particular variety is Crimson Princess. It's the most dwarf of the series. It's grown primarily for the foliage. Most people look at this and they're going to think it's a Laura Petalum because of that wonderful black purple, but it's actually, it is an azalea. It's in the southern end, the Formosa series. It's a red Formosa sport. It's not really grown for its flower.
Right.
So, and I thought, why not add some of this lime green grass? Picks up this color, gives you another texture, adds some height. It's like with any combination in a planter, they tell you to have a spiller, a filler, and a thriller. So we've got all three.
A spiller, a filler, and a thriller.
Yep.
Okay, well, I think we might remember that.
Yep.
You got to tell us about the little conifer there on the end.
Well, this was a great find, a very happy moment. I've got the perfect container for this plant. This is a fairly rare form of the dwarf Hinoki cypress. We used to have a larger variety back in the Japanese garden, and it unfortunately did not survive all of our work, so we have one that will someday replace it.
And this is Costeri, is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so a lot of people are familiar with the typical Hinoki,
yeah,
Canisiparis, but
this one's very tall, thin, very weepy, very cylindrical. It's unusual, and I was happy to find it locally.
So just as a recap, Mark, we're going to choose a container we like, color. Generally, in my experience, although you're much better at putting containers together than I am, but it's always, from my experience, it's always better to have a bigger container rather than a smaller one.
Yeah.
At the largest you can get, because it always seems like you don't ever have enough root area.
Yeah.
To put all the cool stuff you want to do. If you want to be more traditional, maybe the annual flowering stuff, the cabbages and the kales and the pansies and the violas, but you can put just about anything in there. And tell them one more time. The spiller.
A spiller, a filler, and a thriller.
Okay. Mark, the containers look great. Lots of opportunities to see different combinations here at containers here in the Arboretum Garden. One thing you need to remember about containers, though, they do dry out more readily than something growing in soil, so make sure you keep some water on them, especially during the cold parts of the year. You don't want those plants going through cold periods without adequate water. The other thing is fertilizer. The best thing to do is some kind of control-release fertilizer that you just add to the container after you finish planting it. Osmocote is one that you normally think about. After the break, we'll join Chantel Welker in the kitchen.
What we do to the planet, we do to ourselves. You can help keep America beautiful. Visit kab.org.
Welcome back to the Coastal Gardener. I'm Chantel here in the kitchen. In the cold months that we're in right now, there just aren't a whole lot of fruits and vegetables that are in season right now. However, there is the sweet potato that's available year-round here in North Carolina. In fact, North Carolina is the nation's top producer of sweet potatoes, and here in eastern North Carolina, we are the top producers for North Carolina of sweet potatoes. So, some of the dishes you might traditionally think of using sweet potatoes in would be candied sweet potatoes or a sweet potato pie. How about a sweet potato biscuit? You may not have tried that before. Biscuits are one of the easiest breads you can make, so I'm going to show you today how to make a sweet potato biscuit. And the nice thing about adding the sweet potatoes is you add a lot of vitamins with it. So first thing you'll need to do is go to the store, pick out your sweet potatoes or your local farmer's market. Just try to look for one that is nice and firm, very colorful, not starting to shrivel. And then once you get them home, back to the kitchen, you just want to wash them and chop them up. So what we're going to do is just boil them to make them soft. And we're going to make a puree out of it, so we can add that to the biscuit recipe. And if you've already got a lot of sweet potatoes from the season, what you can do is home can them. These would need to be pressure canned because of the low acid they have. So if you do that, they're already going to be nice and soft for you, ready to go. But if you just got them from the store, just chop them up into small pieces so that they can cook faster. Get a pan of water, put the sweet potatoes in and cook them for about 20 minutes till they're soft. I've already got some here that I've done. You can just prick it with a fork and you'll see it's nice and soft. And then you just go ahead. Once you start cooking with me a lot, you'll see that I use a food mill a lot, and you're going to need to do that if you're cooking straight from the garden, especially with some of these firmer fruits and vegetables like the apples, the pumpkin, sweet potato. A food mill really helps out with using those fruits and vegetables. So I've just gone ahead and poured these in here. Give that a little stir. And the nice thing about doing the food mill too is you don't have to peel it in advance. It kind of peels it for you. Just press that down in there. And all we need for today is about a cup of sweet potatoes pureed. can see it just comes out kind of stringy down here. But that's okay. It's perfect. Probably need a little bit more. And the nice thing about a biscuit recipe is it goes really well by itself if you just want a little bit of a snack, or it can be eaten with a meal as a side dish. Instead of maybe a traditional dinner roll, a biscuit is something that's really goes with any meal. You can have it with for breakfast with a little bit of jelly, or just heat it up. It's good all on its own. Or you can have it with dinner with a meat dish or something. It's very versatile. And this recipe, it has very few ingredients. It's got butter, milk, flour, a little bit of sugar, salt, and baking powder. I'm just gonna measure this out, see if I've got about a cup. Let me grab that. All right, I've measured that out. Got about a cup. Maybe need to do a little bit more. Get some extra sweet potatoes in there. And once we get this all ground up, then we'll add the milk to it. Got our sweet potato ready to go. Next, I've got a third cup of milk here. Now I've used fat-free milk. A lot of biscuit recipes you'll see out there call for half and half or heavy cream. You can use those, it'll add a little bit of flavor, but it's also gonna add a lot of calories and fat to it. So I recommend using this fat-free milk to cut down on some of those calories. And you'll see once you get them out of the oven all ready to go, and they're going to taste wonderful. So just mix that in with the sweet potato. And over here in this other dish, I've already got my flour, baking powder, salt, and sugar. Now there are a couple different options you can use with flour. What I've used is self-rising flour, or you can use all-purpose flour. The difference mainly is self-rising flour, it's already got your baking powder and your salt in there. And if you look at the quantities in there, it will have a little sidebar on there telling you how much. And for this recipe, it calls for a little bit less salt than what is already in the self-rising flour. So that's one thing to consider when you're choosing. If you have something that's already preset, it may have different ratios of the ingredients than what you might be looking for, but that's just something for you to choose personally when you're making it. So I've got my flour here, got my sugar in it, and it calls for 5 tablespoons of unsalted butter. You don't need that extra salt. Just put those in, and you don't need to melt it because these are gonna be cut in. When you're cooking a biscuit, you cut it in with a pastry blender to get the little, that's what helps it give the flakiness. Just gonna cut that in. And if you cut it into the little portions, it helps it be easier to blend up in there too. Just cut that in. It'll start to have kind of a pebble-like consistency once you've got it all in there. The other nice thing about biscuits is they don't have yeast in them, so you don't have to worry about letting them rise or punching it down or anything like that. So it's a very quick recipe to make. So it's just about all mixed in. can see it really doesn't take that long to get it mixed up. Yeah, I'm starting to not see any big chunks, starting to have little balls in here of the flour mixed with the butter. So that's just about where we want it. Now we've got that in, all we need to do is add the puree and the milk. Now, one thing you'll want to be aware of when you're making a biscuit, if you've never made a biscuit before, you really want to have a certain consistency before you ever start rolling it out and working it. Biscuits are supposed to be somewhat moist before you start rolling it out, and so you want to keep an eye on it as you're mixing it, see how that texture looks. If it's really dry, it's going to come out dry out of the oven, so you might need to add in a little bit of milk, and it looks like I'm probably going to have to do that here. But you don't want to add a whole lot extra right at once. You want to kind of do it a little bit at a time. You just want to add it until you get that stickiness to where the ingredients are kind of holding together, but you don't want it to be dry. It's not going to be an enjoyable biscuit. Just need a little bit more. Starting to come together really nice here. And you can see when you pat it with a spoon, it kind of just barely sticks to it. So let's clear some space here for my dough. I'm going to roll it out. You just want to put a little bit of flour on the counter to keep it from sticking to it. Just get the dough all at once. Just plop it down on there, one big ball. So you can see it's pretty sticky, but you want it to, that's exactly how you want it to be. But I'm going to just put a little bit of flour sprinkled on top so the rolling pin doesn't stick to it and kind of pat that around. Then you roll it out to about half an inch or 3/4, it just depends on how thick you want it to be and how many rolls you want to get out of it. This one, it's going to make, if you do it at about half inch, you're going to get about 16 biscuits out of it. But it doesn't have to be exact. You just don't want it too thin or you just won't have much to bite into. So just roll that out. Then I've got a little cup here. This is going to be my little biscuit cutter. You can use something similar at home. You can use a glass, whatever you've got around. And just get a little bit of flour on the edges of that. And this recipe, if you want 16 out of it, you want to have about a 2-inch biscuit. So this glass I've got here, it's about probably 2.5, so it's a little bit bigger, so I might not get quite that many out of it. So if you're doing maybe a party or something, you can do a smaller and just have little bites of biscuits, just whatever you want. Just going to cut that. You can see it's nice and fluffy. And pretty much any biscuit recipe you use, it's going to have the same basic ingredients with about the same quantities of flour and salt and baking powder. Those are your basic ingredients for a biscuit. And then you can add the different things, like you can do a cinnamon sugar biscuit, or you can do these sweet potato biscuits, but they all basically follow the same general flow as far as what kinds of ingredients and rolling it out. So once you get this recipe down, you can make a wide variety of biscuits. So I've just got my pan here. I'm gonna put a little bit of cooking oil on it just to keep it from sticking. Then all you do is just grab them. You can see they're, even though it was sticky when we took it out of the bowl, it's still just holding together very nice. You'll probably want to put them about half an inch apart from each other, so that way if they do expand, they're not right on top of each other. But biscuits typically don't change size a lot from when you put it on the pan to when it comes out of the oven. So if you want to cook a lot at once, no big deal. You can see I've got about 9 here. I've got this extra dough here. You can just roll that up and roll it out with a rolling pin and get some more out of it. Just don't put too much flour in it at that point, because it'll start to get really dry. Just pop this in the oven about 400 degrees, and then they take 15 minutes to cook. You just want them to get golden brown. They're done. Sure do smell good. After you get them out of the oven, just put them on a cooling rack for about 5 minutes and then you can eat them. Thanks for joining us today on The Coastal Gardener. Find us on Facebook and let us know if you like the recipes, if you tried them, if you have any suggestions of things you'd like to learn how to cook with. Otherwise, we'll see you next year.